Thank you for downloading this Council on Foreign Relations video. CFR is an independent national membership organization and nonpartisan research center. For more information, please visit us online at cfr.org.
Go ahead and start this very interesting program that we have here for tonight. My name is Edward Schumacher-Matos. I'm honored to be here. I am a lecturer at the Harvard Kennedy School and run an immigration and integration project up there that's new. And I also write a column for the Washington Post Writers Group, so you know who I am on immigration issues. And so tonight we have a very distinguished panel. Before introducing them, let me make a few introductory remarks. We are lucky. This record's on the session, so I don't have to give you the long speech about council rules, et cetera. That also means you can get in trouble. secondly, to please turn off your cell phones. I think with that we're ready to start. So we have three speakers here tonight. Immediately here to my right is Mac McLarty, who everybody knows very well, and I've known Mac since he was at.
To your right.
you used to know how correct you were, John.
Who's on? Now this is one of those who's on first, right? It's your right, and you're right too. when he was chief of staff to Clinton, and then he was the
special envoy,
czar for Latin America, if I can put it that way. And then next to him we have Fran Townsend, who's a partner at Baker Botts and an expert on some of the security issues we have. And then Ted Alden, a former colleague of mine in Waze, that we've met just now tonight for the first time. I even reviewed his book once, that we've never met before, but who used to be with the FT and is now with the Council as the Bernard Schwartz Senior Fellow. So tonight's topic is all about the wonderful report, the Task Force Report on Immigration that came out from the Council. I'm going to ask questions for about 20 minutes, and then when we'll open it up to the audience. And let me just start with Mac, who's next to me. Mac, really, what's the chance for immigration reform, or any kind of a comprehensive immigration reform like what you're recommending here in this report? Because it can be argued that we can just live with the status quo as much as this report said we can't.
It can be argued, but I don't think it's the better side of the argument, Ed. First of all, good evening to everyone who took the time to come. Ed, it's good to be with you. Ed is accustomed to asking me questions. He did that repeatedly when he was with the Wall Street Journal in his prior life and we were in the White House. No one's more knowledgeable in Latin American issues than Ed Schumacher. It's good to be with Fran and Ted, who just did a great job in his support of our effort. And I worked with Fran in the Clinton administration, and of course then she served ably at Department of Homeland Security in the Bush administration. Ed, you can make that argument, and I think the initial point that the economic challenges that we're facing as a nation make it more difficult to move the immigration issue forward. And I think that's true in the short term. But I think if you look in the medium term, to put it in a political context, President Obama's first term, the prospects for comprehensive reform, while difficult to forge a bipartisan consensus, and it will have to be done, I think, on a bipartisan basis, one, because of the issue, and two, just from a pure vote counting standpoint, I think you can make a compelling case that those on the left of the political spectrum and those voices on the right of the political spectrum neither are pleased with our current immigration system because the policies and the realities don't match. So it's not working well from anyone's perspective, but it's still very difficult to forge a consensus to move forward to work through a complicated, difficult, emotional issue. But I think you can make a compelling case that it is clearly in our national interest to do so. One, from an economic standpoint, I think we met with a group of university college presidents this morning. Much of our technology, our new thinking in science and engineering are the result of students who have come here and studied from other countries. that's been a great source of patents and other very cutting-edge technology. Two, we need the workers in certain industries in this country that have been filled by immigrants, in some cases illegal immigrants. Secondly, I think from a security standpoint, which Fran can speak to very thoughtfully, you can make that case, Ed, two ways. One, I think to have undocumented people here not knowing where they are, that's a serious concern. There's 12 million undocumented people in our country. But more fundamentally, and it goes to the values issue, Ed, I think around the world when you have an immigration policy that's not working, I just simply do not think that reflects American values around the world. And unless we win the hearts and minds of the people around the world, have their best and brightest come here, and our young people go there, this is an increasingly small world. As all of you know, we are not going to be as successful in that endeavor as we need to be. So I think the case is there to be made. It will have to have presidential and executive branch support and strong support from both sides of the aisle. I think that will probably come to pass, hopefully, and I believe in after the midterm elections. I don't think in the near term. I think it's unlikely as much as we'd all like to see it. Others may have a different opinion, but given the challenges of the economy, the foreign policy challenges we're facing, and certainly with health care, having had to sequence legislation when I was privileged to serve in the White House, I think the market won't bear quite that much legislation until a little bit more down the line.
Well, Fran, let me skip you to follow up on his question and jump over to Ted on another political question that's got to do with Washington. Can Obama spend the political capital? Do you think that from where you sit, that the administration is willing to spend the political capital to try and push this thing through, or are they just willing? You find a willingness of the administration just to accept the status quo as much as they may not like it?
You're hitting me initially with a tough question. See, my job on the task force was to try to build the consensus. So one of the ways you try to build the consensus is not to get out too far in front on the questions of political feasibility. But I'll jump into it anyway. I think that the administration has committed itself on a number of different occasions. I think Obama did it in the election campaign. I think they've done it a number of times since taking office, particularly to Hispanic audiences. That's when it gets repeated most. But they have committed to take on this issue. So I think at some point they are going to have to take it on. I think they are going to have to make a good faith, serious effort to do immigration reform legislation. Now, whether they're going to put the sort of muscle behind it that it's going to take to succeed, I think that's the real question. I don't think they're just going to let this issue lie fallow for the whole of the president's first term. I think there will be an effort, but with the multiple different things they're juggling, as Mac mentioned, the real question is mm-hmm. is how determined, how hard a push you'll see on that front.
Fran, can we say that in fact enforcement is already starting to work and that's taken off some of the
good question.
The priority on this, on the one hand, and on the other hand, may lead to a situation as the pro-immigrant people say that we're now getting to it's enforcement first and enforcement forever. And why can't we do that?
Yeah, it's interesting because we skip me on politics. That shows very good judgment, Ed. As Mac mentioned, I worked both in the Clinton administration and then in the Bush administration. I was at the White House and actually one of the point people on immigration, comprehensive immigration reform that failed in the 2006-2007, which was in the second half of the second term of the Bush administration. I will tell you, we wind up with an enforcement first because let's be honest about what the politics were. President Bush was undone by his own party. There was bipartisan support. I mean, who in the world who's worked in Washington would have thought you could have had a McCain-Kennedy bill, and you did. And so there really is broad bipartisan support for comprehensive reform. Here's the problem. The government, over multiple administrations, Democratic and Republican, lost credibility with the American people on the enforcement issue. And so I think what you saw was an acknowledgement of that and reverting to let's get the enforcement piece right. Let's put aside how you define right for a minute. And what you've seen with Secretary Napolitano, and I've spoken with her on this issue, is she wants to demonstrate that she is serious about enforcement. She may go about it differently, and she's obviously entitled to do that, but she's also putting real resources, policy resources, in the Department of Homeland Security to orchestrate, one, a very thoughtful, I think, approach to comprehensive immigration reform, if the politics gets right and they can do it, without lessening the notion that she still takes enforcement seriously. And she's also committed substantial resources in the department, because, of course, if the administration is successful and gets immigration reform, it has resource implications on the Department of Homeland Security. And I take as a positive sign of the administration's intent to confront this issue that they're putting resources in place.
Mm-hmm. Can I just add one thing to Fran? We've done a number of briefings up on the Hill. Mac has accompanied me for some of them, other task force members for other briefings. And a lot of people in Congress are not aware of how much more vigorous the enforcement effort on this issue is than it was until, in fact, quite recently. It was interesting in the drafting of the report. You know, when you do one of these reports, my job is to write drafts, and they go out to the chairs, and they go out to the members. And one early version of the draft I wrote, you know, people need to be aware of how much more vigorous the enforcement effort is now than it was a decade ago. And Governor Bush came back to me, and he said, well, actually, you know, if you look, it's really the last 3-4 years. And that is true. In fact, you go back to 2005, the total number of Border Patrol agents we had in this country was about 10,000. We are about to hit 20,000. In that second term of the Bush administration, you also saw the deployment of technology on the southern border to try and give you a picture of people who are coming across. Of course, we had the fence, which I'm ambivalent about, but I mean, another serious enforcement effort. And a lot of people in Congress were surprised that this is, we're in a very different kind of enforcement situation now than we were even 3-4 years ago, and that's not to mention some of the things that have been done on the detention side, on the workplace side. We can talk about those, but you know, one of the results is, and most of this has to do with the state of the economy, but the number of people coming in illegally into this country across that southern border is at the lowest levels we've seen since the early 1970s. It's a very, very different situation from what we had in the first part of this decade, in the 90s, and even in the 80s.
Let me ask one more political question and then move on to the specific recommendations of the report. Then, Mac, does that mean that politically we're at a situation where you can tell the opponents and the people who are in the middle that, hey, enforcement is working, and now it's ready to go ahead and negotiate the rest of the deal?
You certainly can have a more serious and constructive conversation to try to win the hearts and minds of those in the middle and those that have traditionally opposed immigration. And I think, Ed, none of us, even if we have a philosophy that's inclined toward comprehensive immigration reform, I mean, all of us want to feel there is order and stability and predictability and that we have control of our borders. Everyone wants that. And until you kind of start with that base, it's hard to move forward. But I want to really underscore, it is, in my judgment, a false choice that enforcement and comprehensive reform, they are not mutually exclusive. In fact, I would argue they were absolutely compatible. Mm-hmm. So, yes, it helps a great deal. And one other thing, Ed, I think the technology that from the E-Verify program, not to get too technical, but particularly on workplace enforcement here of illegal immigrants and even the border, as well, of course, Fran and others know this very, very, very much in detail, but the technology has been very, very advanced in the last 2 or 3 years in terms of enforcement. That's been a real positive.
Well, then let's look at the specifics of the report. Mm-hmm. And the recommendations. Then we'll open up to questions. But, Ted, I thought it was interesting that the very first recommendation you listed was attracting skilled immigrants. And I know that was a key thing in your book. You know, and I thought it was almost revolutionary to recommend that, you know, all graduates of American universities automatically get work visas.
Presumptively, not automatically.
Well,
but presumptively.
That's practically saying automatically. Yeah. And so I wonder if you could, expound on that for the group.
Well, this was really in a lot of ways where we started with this work, and It goes back to, you know, why should the Council on Foreign Relations be involved in an issue like this at all? I mean, in a lot of respects, right, this is a domestic policy issue. This is not the sort of thing most of you come to the Council on Foreign Relations to hear about. So why take on an issue like this? And I think the fundamental reason we took it on was a recognition that immigration has been a fundamental part of America's success in the world. And a lot of the early part of the report goes through that. It's been important because we have attracted talented people here to our universities, and those people have gone on to form companies in Silicon Valley and elsewhere there that have employed hundreds of thousands, millions of people, and put us at the cutting edge of many technologies. It's important because we've educated people who have gone back home and become business and political leaders in their countries. And these are often people who are favorably disposed to the United States and are a tremendous advantage for U.S. foreign policy. So we went essentially through a list of the ways in which immigration has been tremendously important to America's rise as a world power, and is important to us staying there, is vital to the future of our economy and ultimately our national security. So when you look at the issue from that perspective, the question of attracting the best and brightest is very, very high on that list. You know, we're in a world where competitive advantages really matter. And one of the competitive advantages that the U.S. still has very much above any other nation is the quality of our top research universities. If you see a list of the world's 100 best universities, typically 60, 70, 80 of them are American universities. And if you're a talented student at the top of your field from around the world, you want to come to the United States and you want to study here. And that brings tremendous benefits to this country. So the report looks at, look, how can we take advantage of this? We've done a lot of things, unfortunately, in recent years to discourage those students rather than encouraging them. And the report tries to flip some of the debate on its head to say, immigration policy is not all about deciding who we keep out. It's about deciding who we want to bring in, attracting people that we want to be part of our country. So in a way, we were trying to flip the debate a bit on its head, which is, sorry, it's a long answer, but that's why we started there in the report.
Well, the companion to what we do for high-skilled workers is what we do for low-skilled workers. Mm-hmm. One of the recommendations in the report is for an expanded temporary worker program. That is a hornet's nest, as you know, on all sides. In this case, the unions are, and we're in a Democratic administration, don't particularly like temporary workers programs, though they say they'll go along with some. The Hesburgh Commission in the 70s were opposed to it. The Jordan Commission in the 90s were opposed to a temporary workers program. We killed the Bracero program back in the 60s, largely for civil rights and humanitarian reasons and all sorts of abuses. Fran, what makes you think that this time you can have a temporary worker program and make it work?
Sorry, just quickly, I don't think that's a completely fair rendering of what we were much more ambivalent about a temporary worker program, but
You actually try to cut it all ways with your proposal.
I'm hoping
Fran will try to explain that to us. Not to be too hard on you guys.
You had to report carefully.
Well, I think you need to put this in the context of, during the Bush administration, we did suggest a temporary worker program, and it was part of a very contentious piece of the overall proposal. There was not, by any stretch, consensus on the task force in terms of a temporary worker program. There were articulated by some of the members concerns, civil rights concerns, but it was interesting. Those who came from an enforcement background said time and again, as you were talking to folks who had been picked up in immigration raids or worksite enforcement, they heard over and over again people saying, look, I want to work, I send the money home to my family, I want to go back, that's where my family is, I want to go back. And it was funny, the government's notion when we tried this during the Bush administration was to provide a vehicle for those to do it legally, so they didn't have to sneak and they didn't have to worry about being arrested. And so the government was actually quite well-intentioned when it proposed this. I do understand the concerns of my colleagues on the task force, but I do think that there's a way to manage it now. Now we tried to cut it all ways. I think what you've seen in terms of the task force's recommendation is an acknowledgement that no one thinks there is the perfect temporary worker program. But what the task force could agree on was, if you had such a program, if you provided such a vehicle, it should have the following sort of attributes to it, to make it fair and to make it safe and to allow people that opportunity.
Ed, two grace note follow-ups to affirm and build on what Fran said. First of all, I think we did try to put forward this notion of a commission, which Senator Abraham and Lee Hamilton had recommended in an earlier report on immigration, to give full credit where credit's due, but to regulate the flow and regulate it up when we needed more workers, and frankly, regulate it to a lower level as we have now in a economy that's not nearly as robust in construction and many of the areas, although I think agricultural will continue to have a need for temporary workers. Secondly, and I think importantly, those of you who have had the interest in seen the report and taken time to look at it, you will note a very broad political spectrum represented on our task force, beginning with Governor Jeb Bush and me, just to start, as co-chairs, obviously, of two different political persuasions. But you had, for example, Eliseo Medina from SEIU. You had Dr. Richard Land from the Southern Baptist Convention. You had Mr. Bonner, who served with Fran in the customs area. You had Representative Don Kerwin from the Catholic Church. So you had a very broad group. And my point is, not only was it a great joy and pleasure to work with them, but we reached consensus on the report with very little dissenting opinions, which are usually traditional in a CFR report to have a few dissenting opinions by certain members, but not that they did not endorse the overall report, just on one specific issue. So I think, Ed, that suggests that you can reach agreement. Now, there's some fine points in legislation that would be more difficult to reach than even an August CFR report, but I think that's an encouraging sign.
Well, we have nearly 12 million illegal immigrants here today, mm-hmm. And the report recommends an earned legalization. We see you didn't use the word amnesty in there, which may not actually be honest. I mean, it really is an amnesty, frankly. Isn't it?
Yeah. I don't think so. No.
What, or why not, and what do you recommend?
You want to take that? I mean, I'm passionate on that, but you...
Yeah, so do I. Yeah. I mean, and having...
We all are. We.
But and having... You're right. I probably just bear more scars than my colleagues up here, because, of course, that was the lightning rod during the immigration reform debate in 2006-2007 that failed. Amnesty suggests to me, and to others in the task force as we were drafting this, that there was no penalty. You came illegally, you broke U.S. laws, and there was going to be this broad amnesty where you were just sort of forgiven and allowed to stay. And that's not what the task force's recommendation is. It was not, by the way, what the recommendation of the prior administration was when we advocated for immigration reform. You'll see when you look at the report, there's the notion of integration, language, history. There's the notion of fines. You'd have to demonstrate that you are supporting yourself and paying taxes. I mean, there's a whole series of things that you'd have to be able to prove that you were willing to earn the right to a path to citizenship. And so it really is misleading to call it or suggest that anything that had that many attachments to it and conditions to it in any way was amnesty.
Well, one of the things that struck me that's related to all this, and picking up on what Max said, this commission that you proposed that sort of picks up on the Migration Policy Institute.
Right, that's correct.
You guys endorsed that as
yep.
a...
Mm-hmm, we did.
And it would be an independent commission that... would make annual recommendations of what the various visa levels should be for both temporary and permanent immigration. The Chamber of Commerce doesn't like this idea, and we have many business people in the audience who might share that it smacks of central planning to try and have somebody who thinks they can project what labor needs in the country are going to be. Which of you want to respond to that and explain a little bit more? And while you're at it, you might add that you're also going to punish businesses with your employment enforcement.
If they break the law.
Is that asking too much of the business community?
Let me start it, Ted, then you can pick up with the specifics. But just from a business standpoint, having been in the business sector now for 40 years as a third generation and now fourth generation family business endeavor, and having had the privilege to serve as a chief executive of a New York Stock Exchange company before I took partial leave of my senses and left to Washington for a few years, I think very specifically to me, doing immigration reform the right way strengthens our economy and makes us a stronger country in a number of ways. So I think it's pro-business in that sense, pro-economy and much more broadly from a social standpoint. I think the enforcement, you've got to have a verifiable way to identify someone who's here illegally. And those companies that adhere to those strict procedures, they should have a carrot that you can hire people. You should have a stick if they follow that, they will not be punished. But if they've not followed, if someone's hiring people illegally, underpaying them and so forth, below minimum wage, they should be punished. And that's the way just in any business. So I think that's the place to start. As far as central planning, I wouldn't characterize it that way, nor would Republican Senator Spencer Abraham or very thoughtful centrist Lee Hamilton either, who proposed that initial deal. Ted, you want to pick up on
that? Just expand a little bit on the commission idea, because intriguing. In my thing, I started from a slightly different place than the MPI report. I come out of, I've followed international trade issues for many years, and one of the things that strikes me about international trade, if you have a question about the impact of trade on the U.S. economy, say you want to know, what would the effect be of lowering tariffs on a certain kind of steel pipe, you've got an organization called the International Trade Commission that you can go and get an answer to that question. We have nothing like that sort of professional capacity in the government with respect to immigration. Despite the enormous impact that immigration has on our economy, we have almost no professional capacity in the government to study it and understand it. So in my mind, if all we did was succeed in setting up a professional commission that did nothing but research and was able to answer questions, we'd be well ahead of where we were now. I would like to take, and the task force recommended taking it, the next further step, which is a commission that has powers to recommend to Congress adjustments of overall levels. And it's really not central planning. We looked, for instance, at the question of a point system that a number of countries use, like Canada and the UK, where if you want to immigrate, they have a whole list of criteria, and if you meet those, you can come into the country. They have often found in countries that have that kind of system a real mismatch between the skills of the immigrants coming in and what the economy actually needs. We like that aspect of the American system that at least on the employment side, companies are able to go out and identify foreign workers that they'd like to hire and bring them here. We would keep that. But the idea of having a group of professionals that could say, look, the economy is headed south. We're in a period of time where we should pull in the reins a little bit or look forward and say, well, we can see labor demands going out and there's an argument for increasing capacity. That just makes a lot of sense. The Australians have had that in place. It's worked quite well. I think we're really just undergunned in terms of understanding the economic impacts of immigration and being able to respond to that.
And Ed, I would add to that the recognition that look how many presidents have tried to do immigration reform over the years and how often has it been successful. This is a very difficult issue, and so rather than force future presidents into a position where you have to seek wholesale legislative reform, a commission allows the executive branch some flexibility to articulate in a changing environment as opposed to set numbers or set procedures.
Well, let me ask one last question before opening it to the audience. And Fran, I think I'll direct it first at you, but anybody else can jump in. The last thing is family-based immigration, and that's really what we've had since 65. The overwhelming number of immigrants allowed into permanently allowed into the country have come in under a family-based system. You guys cut back on it just a little bit, but not a lot. I mean, and this looks like another committee thing trying to have it all ways, it looked like to me.
Yes.
But I wonder.
Nuanced approach.
But I wonder if you might.
Sure.
Yeah, good point.
Two-thirds, I think the number is about two-thirds of those who come in on this family-based process. Here's, there was vigorous debate about whether we should do away with it altogether. There wasn't real support for doing away with family-based vehicles altogether. There was some consensus for scaling it back. If you look at how far beyond the nuclear family people can come in, there was a sense that there are driving economic needs, and in the current environment, in the current system, it would be better to readjust the notion of a family-based reason to bring in folks. So it was more restrictive. So it really was, in the way you think of your nuclear family, you could sponsor them. But that would give you additional numbers of immigrants under the current system, where you could try to use those numbers to attract, say, highly skilled worker and technical workers. Mm-hmm. It was a compromise, though.
Well, let me open it up to the audience. John?
John Bradamus, I'm the son of an immigrant, Bradimas. My father was born in Greece. I'm the first Greek American elected to the Congress of the United States. And my wife is of Polish origin. So that explains why I'm here tonight. This has been a most impressive.
She kicked you out, or?
No, not yet. But I'll tell you what I miss. You've not told us why we're here. In other words, what is the issue that poses the need for immigration reform? You've not said that. Our distinguished speakers have made comments on various dimensions of the issue, but I've not yet read the book, but I'd like to know, what's the problem?
I thought that was our first question, but let's go back to it.
I think Matt gave an excellent answer, but I mean, I can reiterate. I think there are problems on multiple dimensions. I think the most obvious problem, which has been the focus of a lot of the attention, is that we have, the most obvious problem that has been the focus of a lot of attention, is that we have 11 or 12 million people living in this country illegally, that people who are not authorized to be here. So there's a big rule of law problem. I think a second problem that we have is there are a lot of people under our legal immigration system who are living in this country in a temporary status for years and years and years because the backlogs for getting green cards for permanent residents are so long, and they particularly hit skilled people from certain countries like China and India, where we have nationality quotas that restrict that very seriously. And then I think finally it reiterates the first point. We've got a big enforcement problem. I mean, We've got a security problem that arises from the fact that we don't know anything about a lot of people who are living here. We don't have control over who's coming to the country, and that until we establish that control, it's going to be difficult to move forward. So I think there's been a consensus for a long time that the system is badly broken, and it's broken on a number of different dimensions, which is maybe why it's hard to give you a very kind of short, clear characterization of it. But it's not a system that's working very well from many different perspectives.
Brian?
Thank you, Ed. Brian O'Neill, council member. Ed, I liked your first question, and Mac, I liked your response to it. I certainly agree that the president's agenda is fully occupied with the economy, the wars, with healthcare reform, and even financial sector reform. But I certainly agree that the immigration as we know it now no matter where you are on the spectrum, you're unhappy about it. It's not working well. I happen to believe that there's some overlap, however, between free trade. Mm-hmm. The free flow of goods, services, investment, and human capital, and human resources.
I agree with that.
The first 4 years of the Obama administration, can we get either one of those on the agenda? Will there be traction for either one, or will basically they both be crowded out?
Well, I hope not, and I don't think so. I think on immigration reform, as complicated and emotional and difficult issue as it is, I believe that for both Democrats and Republicans, it would be bad politics not to address immigration reform. Now, specific congressional districts, that's a different calculation. But overall, from a Democratic side, which controls the Congress and the White House, this has been promised. The Hispanic vote largely went to the Democratic side, not in terms of responding just to the vote, but just responding to a situation that is broken, not working, and is not in our national interest. And the Democrats have the votes to do something about it. From the Republican side, and Governor Bush obviously could speak to this much more eloquently and thoughtfully than I can, but I think you've got, without a broadening of their ability to attract Hispanic voters and other, broaden their base, they will simply, in my judgment, not be successful in many of their elections. So I think this is one-time policy and politics overlap. Now, Brian, you and I have worked on trade issues together and investment issues together, both before your very dedicated and capable time in government and when I was privileged to serve. The trade issue is also an emotional issue, but I think if the right bill can be produced, the right structure can be produced, we should be able to move forward there as well. I don't think that is quite as certain, in my judgment, as an effort on immigration reform. The final point I would make, Ed, on this, I think it's important. It is hard for me to see how you engage with the world in this economy with all of the issues if you're not forward-leaning on immigration and trade. There's a real inconsistency there, in my opinion.
In the back of the room, Vera.
Thank you. Joseph Shammy from the Center for Migration Studies. First, congratulations to the committee finishing a report. I have two questions. First, it concerns the environment. Given that immigration has an enormous impact on the growth of the U.S. population, estimated at some 70% between now and mid-century, my question is, why did the task force choose not to discuss the environmental consequences of this immigration and rapid growth that we'll see over the next four decades? Mm-hmm. The second question is, considering that the 1986 IRCA immigration reform that Reagan passed with Congress failed, it illegalized, had a path to legalization, amnesty for about 3 million. That failed, that grand bargain. Why should the public this time believe you that this will work, and why would it work if it didn't work before? Thank you.
Let me take the second question first, and then Ted, on the environmental issue, if you and Fran would perhaps take that. You raise a very valid point and concern about the 1986 legislation with President Reagan and the grand bargain. That did not produce some of the results and goals and objectives that it was so much hoped it would do. I think one of the central differences, you had about 2,000 or 3,000 at the most border people dedicated to border patrol. You now have 20,000 people on border control. It's been a very high priority of the Bush administration and now of the Obama administration. You have, as head of Homeland Security, following Secretary Chertoff, who I think did a fine job with the able support of Fran Townsend and others, but you've got a former governor of Arizona who understands these issues. You've got technology that gives you much more control of the borders. And so I think it's a very different time and place. And our economy is a very different economy than it was in 1986. So I think you can make the case that we can learn from what did not go as we had hoped and planned in 1986. This is a very different time. I think we can deal with those issues quite effectively and, in fact, are in the midst of doing so. In terms of the environmental standpoint, I think you, again, raise a very appropriate question. And, Ted, I'll let you and Fran go ahead and address some of that, and we'll go from there.
I mean, I think with respect to the environmental issue, I think there were a number of things that we really didn't take on in this report that have very much to do with the domestic side of immigration. I mean, we saw our mandate as very much talking about a lot of the international aspects of this, what it means to the U.S. economy, what it means to U.S. security. The environment is absolutely a legitimate issue. So are issues surrounding education, surrounding integration and assimilation, which we touched on briefly, but not in any great detail. Pressures on local hospitals and schools, which again, we kind of touched on, but didn't go into any great detail. So in a lot of ways, I think it falls into that. A broader point I would make is that a lot of the pressure on the environment results from the fact of a growing global population. So we are going to deal with these environmental issues, whether they're here in the United States or whether they're in China, where they're building, you know, a new coal-fired plant every 2 weeks, or whether they're in India. So the environmental problems really have become global problems that we're going to need to address on a global scale. Obviously, there are many national and local dimensions as well, but it's not a problem that you really solve, it seems to me, through immigration policy.
Yes, ma'am.
How are we going to address the issues that we already know about, the 11 or 12 million people that are here illegally? Who's supposed to be finding out their whereabouts and how to deal with them? And the poor enforcement of the guest worker programs, which states know about, and the people that employ the guest workers are not living up to the obligations forced upon them. They're taking advantage of the guest workers, and there's no recourse for these workers, seemingly.
Let me start with the issue of the 12 million, which is the most confounding problem if you're in the executive branch. So I don't envy my successors this one. This is the notion that we know where they are, and it's just a matter of going, knocking on the door, and sending them back is a fallacy. We don't know where they are. We don't have near the resources that we require to go get them. And so let no one pretend, other than, sort of sniping at each other, that you can go find the 12 million and throw them out. You have to have priorities. And what I think you've seen in the enforcement effort that Mac alluded to is trying to, frankly, make those priorities real, working with state and local law enforcement for people who are here illegally with criminal records, people who pose a terrorism threat to this country, making them a priority. But not just on the security and enforcement side from a sort of a national security perspective. By the way, a lot of the worksite enforcement is cracking down on employers who are doing the very thing that you suggest, and that is taking advantage of illegal or undocumented workers. And so that's got a double-edged sword. By the way, we're going to send the message to employers that there are rules they must follow or pay a price, plus we're going to be able to protect people. And the Secretary Napolitano has, I think largely based on her experience as the governor of Arizona, changed the paradigm of even how they do worksite enforcement. And so that's not a 100% answer, but I think if someone in the executive branch currently serving were here, they'd say to you, you've got to start somewhere. And then as you begin to work down your list of priorities, recognizing you're never going to identify all 12 million, that's where you end up with having the conversation about an earned citizenship, an earned path to citizenship.
Just a quick comment on the guest worker issue. I mean, the worst situation you can have is the one we've got now, where a lot of these so-called guest workers are actually illegal immigrants. And so they're completely at the mercy of their employers because they're vulnerable to being recognized and deported. So Mac mentioned Eliseo Medina of the Service Employees Union, who was a member of our task force. I mean, they have a terrible time trying to identify and organize these people to improve their working conditions because they're not here legally, so they've got no leg to stand on. A second thing, if we're expanding legal guest worker programs, one of the things we talked about in the task force is you have to have programs where these people can change jobs, that they're not tied to a particular employer. If you've got a system where the employer goes and it picks a particular guest worker from Mexico and brings him in, and the only way that person can stay is working for that employer, that's a situation that really is subject to abuse. They're in a kind of indentured status. So they have to have the freedom to change jobs. So I think those two things would be a big improvement on the status quo that we've got now in terms of these questions of abuse of workers.
And let me make one quick point about the 12 million undocumented illegal immigrants who are here, because that is obviously a very central, difficult, emotional issue. And I just want to be sure we don't leave the wrong impression with our audience tonight or with the report. We certainly try not to. Ted noted it. This is not where any of us would like to be. this is really reflecting an immigration policy that has not worked well, and it reflects, frankly, that we have not had the ability to really secure and control our borders. It also reflects kind of the state of humankind, if you want to look at it that way, where largely, not exclusively, but largely, those that came here illegally from Mexico and other countries south of the border came here to earn money to provide for their families because they could not find employment there. And if you put it just in a strictly a moral sense, a human sense, that is breaking the law. There's no way to get around that. But it puts it in a little broader context. So I think the real essence here is we've got to deal with reality. We have 12 million, approximately, undocumented people who are in our country. We don't know where they are. I don't think that really suggests a real secure situation, right, you know, as a first point. But you can't, one, find them. You can't deport them all back to Mexico. I think not many of us, I don't believe, if we took a show of hands, would say we want enforcement by attrition by enforcement, making things so difficult we force people to go home. Very unfairly in some cases. So we're really trying to come up with a solution to deal with reality and work through this issue as best possible. But I do think, Ed, that not only, frankly, the past legislation, which got mischaracterized on a bipartisan basis, our report and any future legislation, is not amnesty for 12 million people. It is serious, earned legalization, a hard pathway to citizenship, and some will simply not make it. But we need to put it in the context, this is reality, how do we deal with it in the most thoughtful way we can.
Over here, if you could introduce yourself, wait for the mic.
Thank you, Joe Hill, council member. Mac, it's a pleasure to see you again.
Thank you, nice to see you.
This morning, the latest issue of Corporate Counsel landed on my desk, and it contains a very nice interview with you, wherein you set forth your views on the American economy and the international economy and the problems we're confronting. And I think it's fair to say in that article or in that interview, you expect unemployment to remain elevated for quite some time. I'd appreciate it if you could, let's assume we're in fall of 2011, spring of 2012, and unemployment still north of 8.5% or 9%. I'd like you to talk tactically on an unemployment level around 9% and the Obama administration's willingness to pursue immigration reform.
Could I add to that question? I'm going to take the power of the chair here,
yeah.
Prerogative,
yeah.
And say not just the politics of it, but the economics of it. Are you going to make unemployment worse? Whoever's going to take that.
You mean by immigration?
Yes, by this legalizing and by everything else. I mean, are you contributing to the unemployment problem?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think the quick answer to that is no, but I appreciate your referencing the interview. I knew I was going to get in trouble with any kind of prediction about the economy in that interview. But I think Bob Rubin spoke today at lunch right after we had presented to the university and college presidents who were here, and I think the conventional wisdom, which perhaps is wrong, but that we will probably have a slower recovery from a jobs employment standpoint than any of us would like, and that's going to put a lot of pressure on both the president and the Congress, as well as businesses. I think two fundamental points. One, the best environment for any type of difficult legislation is for the majority of people in our country to feel more secure, more hopeful about the future. And if you've got an economy that people feel is getting better, is beginning to get stable in terms of a plan to start attacking the deficit, just the more secure and confident people feel, the more open-minded, receptive they're going to be to working through some difficult issues, particularly if you can make the case and persuade people it is in their interest to do that. That's going to be the challenge. I do think both elections and stock markets and other things are guided by the future. We're always looking to the future and trend lines as opposed to the past. So I think the real essence here is what's going to be that trend line of unemployment. How are we going to be feeling about things, both in the midterm elections and as we approach the next presidential election? So that's how I see it in the context of what you're talking about. Ed, specifically on contributing to unemployment. I really honestly see it just the opposite. I think if you have a qualified labor pool, you're already seeing, obviously, the immigration are just simply not going to come here if the jobs are not here, and we talked about regulating that flow. But I cannot emphasize enough the key, one of the keys to rekindling our economy is innovation and technology, and that is just clearly, undeniably linked to a much more comprehensive immigration effort than we currently have. And look, we've got competition now from around the world in universities and colleges that are having a much more open policy toward attracting the best and brightest from around the world to their colleges and universities. And so we've got to get in this game in a much more competitive manner than we are. So that's how I would see it.
I would add to what Matt said. By the way, I think people would find it surprising, given my background, I think there's a security component to attracting foreign students. We went through a precipitous drop after September the 11th of foreign students not being able to get visas to come into this country. That's been largely corrected. There are still issues with the amount of time you spend in secondary, if you're pulled aside, and all that. In the meantime, while we went through this dip, these foreign countries lightened their immigration laws to attract people. And so when we meet with the college and university presidents, they say, by the way, the market now for us is far more competitive, and we probably will never get back to the overall number we were at. Now, here's why that's a, I tell you that as context, because here's the security issue. Governments dealing with one another will never in the long term solve what I prefer to call it smart power as opposed to soft power. Government to government will never solve that. I don't care how well beloved our current president is. He can't solve it alone. The way those problems get solved over the long term are people-to-people exchanges. It's cultural exchanges, people coming here and making up their own minds on an individual basis, and then they go home and they visit with family and they visit with friends and neighbors and they talk about their experience. Not every one of those will be positive, but I will tell you, if we want to win the battle for hearts and minds, it doesn't happen by our men and women, brave as they are in uniform. It doesn't happen because of politicians. It happens in universities. It happens in cultural exchanges. And I will tell you, as you can see, I am a passionate advocate that from a security perspective, we need to do this, and we don't make that argument. Sorry.
Yes, sir, here in the middle.
Asim Rahman, Deborah Boys in Plimpton. Whose role is enforcement? We obviously know it's a federal issue, but we've already heard today about it, private sector enforcement. We also heard briefly about local law enforcement. Mm-hmm. And what's the balance that's been considered by the task force with respect to the advantages of delegating out mm-hmm. the enforcement responsibilities versus the control that you lose yep. when you delegate that out? As the anecdote we're seeing right now, something play out in the press in the Southwest with a rogue sheriff who's deciding to round up all those immigrants. And that's a side effect of this delegation process. Can you comment on how the task force has approached this issue?
The 280, what he's referring to is called the 287G program. I will spare you all the details of that, but what it allows the federal government to do is to deputize local officials, local law enforcement officials, to enforce federal immigration laws. And there was a discussion among task force members of this. If you are in local law enforcement, it sort of runs contrary to the whole notion of community policing. If you want people who live in local communities to cooperate with the police, if you want women who are domestically abused to be able to call the police and feel comfortable they can do that, you can't have the same policeman who responds to the domestic violence call saying, show me your green card or you're going to get deported. So the prevalent view among police chiefs that I've spoken to has been, we don't really want this responsibility. Now, that said, I do want to have the ability to query the system. So if I have a violent felon and one of my vehicles to protecting my community is using immigration law, I want to know that. I want to have that tool. So there was a whole discussion about we don't want to undermine local police efforts and community policing, but we do want to give them the access to the tools they want. as you might imagine, Commissioner Bonner, the former Customs Commissioner, felt very strong about broad use of 287G. I will tell you, by and large, that program was the result of a lack of federal enforcement resources. So when you take the Customs and Border Patrol and you take them from 3,500 to 20,000, you've begun to address that problem. And while the current administration hasn't really made that argument, I think that is part of the right argument they ought to be making in terms of why they're doing less use of 287G. They've also found the example that you cite, it's you lose control. When you give that authority away, there's the potential to lose control. I'll tell you, in my more than 20 years in the federal government, this is a unique problem because we've used 287G more or less over decades and not had the problem. There hasn't been. We work with local law enforcement. We're satisfied. We train them. We're satisfied they understand the laws and how to enforce them. And this is a one-off. And so I'm always nervous about us thinking about changing laws or authorities because you got one problem.
Professor.
Really good answer.
I would just comment that Joe Arpaio, I guess, who's one of the rogue sheriff, is elected and wildly popular, so I mean, it's maybe an indication that it's more of a political problem than a policing problem. But when Simpson Mazzoli, you know, the Immigration and Customs, the reform of 1986 passed, I think most people thought that part of the great bargain was employer sanctions. And I'm curious why they didn't work. Or why, I guess, apparently the government chose not to enforce them. And then also reflecting back on, you know, Simpson-Mazzoli, why it is, whether we call it legalization or amnesty or whatever, any type of relaxation that's going to present the promise of a future ability to adjust one's status after entering illegally, mm-hmm. Isn't just going to present a beacon of hope that will induce millions of more people to enter the United States illegally, as apparently Simpson Mazzoli did, and apologize for the rambling question.
They're really part of the same question, which is about the failure of the 86 Act. I mean, I think with the question of employers, there were really two reasons. I mean, one of the issues, which remains a real issue, is the question of identification. How do you know that people are who they say they are and that their documents are legitimate? And that continues to be a problem. It was a completely unsolved problem in the 80s and 90s and first part of this decade that you know, people could show up with fraudulent Social Security cards or just give a number, and the employers had no way to verify, and a lot of them didn't try very hard. And so you had an extremely loose system. I think the second thing is there was just never a real will in the government to enforce it. There were never significant resources put into employment enforcement. I think this time around, we have made a lot of progress on that front. There are still real identification issues. They're not solved. But the E-Verify system, which is gradually getting put in place, is the most promising system we've had yet for trying to ensure that employers are hiring people who are legal. And so I think, you know, unlike the 86 situation, you've got a situation here where the two may go in tandem. 86 was, we'll do legalization and we promise to do workplace enforcement. Here I think you have a real possibility of them moving in tandem, of being able to demonstrate that there is workable enforcement at the workplace. The second question on the effects of an amnesty or of any kind of legalization program is a real one. There's no question. I mean, anytime you do this sort of thing, it becomes a potential attraction for people in the future who think, well, if I can get inside the United States and stay there long enough, maybe this will happen again. And you get back to the need for very tough enforcement, which Yep. we've been emphasizing here. You've got to make it very difficult for these people to find work in the United States so that the magnet goes away, and make it very difficult for them to come here through anything but legal channels, which is partly an enforcement issue, and it's partly also making sure that the legal channels are there. I mean, I think that was the last problem with the 86 Act, is that it was a one-off. It was sort of assumed, well, we've solved the problem. We don't need to worry about the fact there's going to be continued demand for labor in the future. So those are all dimensions of the problem that I think we're in a better position to master now than we were.
We have time for one last question. I have three hands on this. Sir? Yes, and then I wonder, madam, and then I think that'll be it. We'll make it the two questions.
It's going to be a short statement question. It starts with Congressman Brademus's question. What is the whole immigration thing really about? And I would like to answer that by saying it's something you haven't even mentioned in this wonderful hour that we've had. You have a United States populace that, if you ever saw that movie Network, they're mad as hell based on every survey that has been made by Rasmussen and a zillion other funding pollsters. The country has had it up to here because they're looking at health care expenses going through the roof. They're looking at their own expenses. They're looking at the decline in their job opportunities, and they want something done, and it's not a political possibility because the Democrats don't want to be tagged with it and the Republicans don't. So my question is, are you not misleading yourself when you say that the wonderful method you have of adding 40,000, which sounds like a lot, it's really not. We have 40,000 TSA guys doing it. That is what has caused the decline in illegal immigrants when you have seen the collapse of our real estate, commercial and domestic, which is where most of these people work. They don't work for big employers. They're working for millions and millions of people all over this country who love them, by the way, because they work well and they work inexpensively. How do you fix the most important thing, which is keeping our borders secure, if you don't even know that what you've done so far is working?
I think this is the last answer, and then we're going to have to end here.
I mean, just quickly, because I don't want to mislead. I think it's clear that the main reason that the illegal immigrant flows across the southern border have dropped so dramatically is because of the state of the economy. People come here to work, and if there are no jobs, they don't come. But that said, we have a far more serious and formidable enforcement effort at that border than we've ever had before. And I can't tell you, you know, that the economy is 70% and enforcement is 30% or 60, 40, or 80, 20, but it's some of both.
Yeah, I think, Bruce, this is both about securing the borders and frankly, dealing with illegal immigrants, but it's also about having the kind of policies that encourage legal immigration to our country that I think has been very much the lifeblood of our economy in many ways in our country in terms of technology. I agree with you, Bruce, that there is great anxiety and even anger. I agree with that. For a lot of reasons, not just about immigration. But I think it's interesting that many of the loudest voices in the Congress against immigration were defeated in the last two elections in the House as well as the Senate. So I think when you have a much broader discussion here, the results might be different than some of us might think.
Well, I think our panelists have done a great job in explaining a very detailed report that itself is a service to the country. And you've been a great service to the audience. You've been a great audience. I think a round of applause for everybody. Thank you.
Thank you. Well done.
Thank you for watching this Council on Foreign Relations video. For additional audio, video, and transcripts of CFR meetings, as well as expert analysis of international news, please visit us online at cfr.org.